If you accuse me of having an oscillating reaction addiction problem, I'd find it hard to argue, and I haven't even touched the old BZ reaction yet. In this column, we've seen color changes, bursts of fizzing, but this time I want to show you how to make a little luminol lighthouse. In previous demonstrations, we've seen how the luminol reaction needs an oxidizing agent, an alkaline environment, and it benefits from the addition of a copper catalyst. We've also seen reactions with competing autocatalytic steps, steps that generate or eliminate a chemical that accelerates the process even more, resulting in oscillations that produce predictable pulsating changes. In our recent case of a gas evolution oscillator, we saw how the change in rate of bubble formation at the supersaturation point increased so much at that point that there could be a quadrillion-fold change in the rate of bubble formation from only a 0.1% change in dissolved gases, which would, in turn, of course, be rapidly exhausted by an explosion of bubble formation. Another such example is the Orban oscillator, where copper ions catalyze the decomposition of hydrogen peroxide, but also get trapped in the +1 oxidation state by complexation by thiocyanate ions in the solution to produce a slightly yellow complex. Where the yellow color fades, copper 2 comes back into play and is available for our purposes today in the oxidation of the luminol as well as in the oxidation of the peroxide. This reaction scales up and down very nicely. I'll show you how to make up enough solution for a total of 250 cm3, like you see here, good for a large class or attracting attention if set up as part of an extracurricular STEM activity. As always, you can find information about how to do this, technician sheets, etc., in the links below on the Education and Chemistry website. We'll need 4 solutions, which I'll label A, B, C, and D. Solution A is 50 cm3 of a 1 molar solution of hydrogen peroxide, made by adding 44 cm3 of water to 6 cm3 of your stock 100-vol peroxide. Remember to always make up your peroxide fresh, and if you're a CLEAPS member, do check out RB045 before making up hydrogen peroxide solutions. Solution B is a 0.15 molar solution of potassium thiocyanate. Dissolve 0.73 grams in 50 cm3 of water. Do not substitute for ammonium thiocyanate, as ammonium ions will inhibit the Orban oscillator. Solution C is an implausibly dilute solution of copper 2 sulfate, approximately 6 × 10⁻⁴ molar, made up by dissolving 0.015 grams in 100 cm3 of water. Now, this is such a small amount that I just tend to weigh a larger quantity, make up like about a litre at a time, and the leftover stuff I can leave in a stock bottle for the future. The final solution, D, is your alkaline luminol mix, made by dissolving 0.06 grams in 50 cm3 of 0.1 molar sodium hydroxide. If you don't have any 0.1 molar sodium hydroxide made up, of course, you can just add 0.2 grams of sodium hydroxide pellets to 50 cm3 of deionized water. You cannot substitute, as I mentioned before, for ammonium hydroxide. Now you need to think about how you want to show the reaction. All you need to do to start it is add solutions A to D in that order in a suitable container with stirring. I like these sort of flat but round bottom flasks, but a conical flask works well as well. Winter is here. I have lowered the blinds, and I'll be honest with you, I started filming during daylight and I've lost the daylight already. So just to give you a sense of the lighting in this room, here's a glow stick here as well, so you can kind of judge how dark you would need in order to get this going. At room temperature, the reaction will continue happily for about an hour, but you'll need to wait a few minutes between flashes, not great for a captive audience, but nice maybe to leave out for a STEM club or a similar event and allow people to be surprised by it. To get flashes every 50 seconds or more frequently, warm the solution to around 40 degrees Celsius, so I've got some warm water here. I did this by actually preheating using this 2-liter flask that you can see on the left of shot, and I placed inside there some 100 ml beakers, and three of those fit quite nicely in there. Heating that solution to about 50 to 60 degrees allowed me to heat up my solutions B, C, and D, and leave my solution A at room temperature, so that when I added everything together at the end, it all came to around 40 degrees Celsius. You will get initial bursts of light, as you saw before, followed by flashes every 50 seconds or so, extending to maybe 70-second intervals by the time the reaction starts to become difficult to see. At this temperature, the whole sequence probably lasts about 10 to 15 minutes, so for the purposes of the video, I have shortened the time between the flashes that you're seeing on screen. You can, however, see the development of the intervals on this RGB plot, where each frame filmed of the reaction mixture was made 1 pixel wide to show the flashing sequence at the correct scale for the time. I've used these small vials for testing out the luminol concentration. My mix is based on one developed by Hernan Pripstein, but other papers had noticed that you could get the luminol brighter at higher concentrations without wrecking the oscillator. So this led me to increase my concentration that you'll see in the instructions on the technician sheet. If you want to do something on a shorter time scale, having like a number of different flasks running side by side allows more frequent flashes to come up to keep your audience's interest. There are all kinds of ways of setting up this reaction, and if you'll forgive the pun, I'm hoping that I might see some of your even flashier versions shared back through the EIC community. So do let us have a know how you get on, share what you come up with. We look forward to seeing that.